Paul wrote these words in 2 Corinthians 7. Great is my boldness of speech toward you. Great is my boasting on your behalf. I am filled with comfort. That's what Paul said. You guys need comfort? Paul was filled with comfort. I'm exceedingly joyful in all our tribulation. That's what Paul said. He's received comfort, and he's exceedingly joyful in his tribulation. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 7. For indeed, when we came to Macedonia, our bodies had no rest, but we were troubled on every side. Paul and his traveling companions were in a pretty difficult spot. Paul continues, we're troubled on every side. Outside were conflicts that we could see. Inside were fears that we could feel. Have you ever been there in the middle of external conflicts, internal fears? Nevertheless, Paul wrote, God, who comforts the downcast, could also be translated God, who comforts the depressed, comforted us by the coming of Titus. Titus brought the comfort of God. And not only by his coming, but also by the consolation which he was comforted in you when he told us, Corinthians, of your earnest desire, your mourning, and your zeal for me, so that I rejoiced even more. Paul's saying things were way tough. There was tribulation, there was conflicts, there was fears, there was depression. But now I've received God's comfort, Paul tells us, in a way that I'm exceedingly joyful. I'm beside myself in the middle of this tribulation, being comforted. God has shown up. God showed up for Paul and his companions, and God completely changed the depressing, fearful situation to one of joy. And he does it like that sometimes, doesn't he? Sometimes it seems like it takes longer. In this situation, God used Titus to bring healing to their hurts. God accomplished what only God could have done. And you know what? He still does it. God's in that business. Here's a couple questions. What if God told you that it was time to quit striving and quit fighting? I think our sister mentioned that today. Let the Lord fight the battle. And Joe's illustration last week, the hovering of the hummingbird, I don't do it quite as good as Joe did. What if God told you to stop flitting like a hummingbird and simply to be found faithful in the place that he's put you by simply obeying him? What if God told you that he wanted you to soar like an eagle and watch him do what only he can do, instead of wearing yourself out doing what you could never do? What if God wanted you to see his true deliverance in your difficult place that you might be in even right now? By simply walking and living in obedience and faithfully being found doing what God's already given you to do. What if he told you that he was going to rescue you from your enemy or your difficulty by simply you quietly and faithfully taking your position that he's given you and to not be afraid of it? What if he told you just to simply do as you were told, continue marching in the place that he put you in, and fully trust that he'll be there for you and he'll take care of the situation? Would you do it? Would you like to see his deliverance so that it's unmistakably God? You see, God really has made his presence known on this earth. He's revealed himself since the beginning of time. Listen to this verse from the chapter 1 of Hebrews. God at various times and in various ways spoke in time past to our forefathers by the prophets in the Old Testament. He's now in these days spoken to us by his Son, Jesus Christ. God the Father has appointed his Son to be inheritor of all things. Through his Son, he made the worlds. His Son is the brightness of his glory. His Son is the express image of his person. While he was upholding all things in this world, By the word of his power, the Son himself also purged our sins. And then his Son, Jesus Christ, sat down at the right hand of his majestic Father on high. The Son of God, our Lord Jesus Christ, is so much better than the angels. And he has, by his inheritance from the Father, obtained a more excellent name than the angels. That's Hebrews 1, 1-4. And you know, the first few chapters of Hebrews simply is making this point. If we would listen to angels, how much more should we be listening to the Son of God himself, the creator of the angels? Yes, God has made his presence known on the earth since the beginning of time, since creating this earth. Sometimes it's more than noticeable. Sometimes perhaps not so obvious to us. But the Lord has revealed himself in different ways. Here's five quick ways. God has revealed himself through the angels. You know, but even before the Lord Jesus came in the Old Testament, he's often called the angel of the Lord. And the New Testament has many examples of God still using his angels or his messengers to bring his messages. And God has also revealed himself through his creation. All of nature tells us of an awesome creator. Remember Psalm 19, the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they proclaim knowledge. Just look around. Just look at the skies. Your spirit will tell you, your spirit made in the image of God will tell you, boy, this isn't by happen chance. In Romans 1, verse 20, for since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power, and even his Godhead, so that they are without excuse. God has so revealed himself in his creation that he has said that those who claim there is no God, but they still look around and see the same things everybody else sees, are without excuse for saying there's no God. There's no excuse for that. The intricacies of this world, whether you're looking with your own eyeballs or with glasses like I need, or whether you're looking through a telescope or whether you're looking through a microscope, all those intricacies point clearly that there's a creator God, and we know it. And but yet, you know, we Americans, we spend billions and billions of dollars going billions and billions of miles to billions and billions of galaxies in pursuit of one tiny possibility that there might be one little tiny bit of like life out there somewhere. And we do that year after year. Yet we look incredibly at clear pictures of a baby conceived in a mother's womb, and we say, no life there, just a blob of lifeless cells. We are without excuse. We really are. God has revealed himself in creation. So yeah, God's revealed himself through angels. God's revealed himself through creation. And according to the Bible, God's revealed himself to our conscience if we haven't hardened it. Our consciousness tells us that God exists. That's what it says in Romans 2, 14 and 15. When even the Gentiles, Paul's writing this as a Jewish man, even the Gentiles who do not have the law, when they by nature do the things in the law, they show that the law is written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness. Their thoughts are either accusing them or else excusing them in the day when God will judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ. People come pre-wired from conception, made in the image of God, with the information that there is a God. There is a right and wrong. We know that. There is truth and lies. You can go anywhere on the earth. You can go to the middle of Africa, the middle of South America, the remotest island, and the people that live there know instinctively, because we're wired in the image of God, that it's wrong for the neighbor to come over and lay with your wife. Without a Bible, without a preacher, they know that's wrong. They know it's wrong to come into your hut or your house and somebody steal your stuff. We're made in the image of God. We're stamped with his image. And those things reveal it to me. According to Scripture, God has put his revelation even in the conscience of men. So yeah, God's revealed through angels, through nature, through our conscience, and God has revealed himself through his word, the Holy Scriptures, the living and active word of God. Paul wrote again to Timothy, You have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it's profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. God has given us, and God has preserved for us His Word so that we can know Him. God's Word reveals God Himself. Jesus told the Pharisees, "You search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and these are they which testify of me." The Scriptures that you read and search are talking about me, Jesus told them. The Scripture is written in the living source that reveals God to us. It's not just information about God or information about heaven and hell. The Scriptures testify of our living God and His redeeming Son. And finally, with God revealing Himself through angels, through creation, through our conscience, through the Bible, God in these last days has revealed Himself through His own Son, Jesus Christ. It should not surprise us that the highest, deepest, divine revelation of God is His own incarnate Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, God in person who came in the flesh, God who was conceived and born of a virgin, God the Son who lived, died, and rose again. God has revealed Himself as the one true Lord in His Son, Jesus Christ. I appreciate a couple weeks ago us saying the Apostles' Creed together, affirming those long-time held biblical beliefs of what the church believes. How did Jesus reveal God? Since God revealed Himself through His Son, Jesus. Jesus Himself reveals God by displaying control over all things. Lots of times in the Gospels. Here's one. In Matthew 4, Jesus said to them, "Why are you fearful? How is it you have no faith?" And they feared exceedingly. And they said to one another, "Who can this be?" When they looked at Jesus. "Who can this be that even the wind and the sea obey Him?" They saw a revelation of God in Jesus and His power. Jesus Himself revealed God by faithfully speaking His Father's words. John records, "He whom God sent speaks the words of God. For God the Father gave Him the Spirit without measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into His hands." Jesus Himself revealed God by appearing as the Father's glorified presence to His disciples. In Matthew 17, while Jesus was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear Him." And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces. And wouldn't you? I'm just about doing it now. And they were greatly afraid. But Jesus came, thankfully, and He touched them. And He said, "Arise, don't be afraid." And they said, "Thank you, Jesus." And Jesus Himself revealed God, finally, and the love of God to us by His coming to earth, His dying, and His resurrection. It was Jesus' own words who said, listen closely, this is a direct quote from Jesus. It was Jesus Himself who said, "For God the Father so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send His Son into the world." Notice Jesus is talking in the third person. "For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved." God has revealed Himself through angels, through creation, through our conscience, through the Word of God, and through Jesus Christ Himself. All these ways testify to the fact that God indeed has revealed Himself. However, God Himself is still intimately involved in human affairs. We don't serve a God who is distant. I think that's a deist understanding, wrong understanding, that God made this world, wound the clock up, and then He went back to the cosmos somewhere and He's not involved. That's not a biblical understanding. A biblical understanding is that we don't serve a God who is distant. He's not a God who just made this world and then conveniently left the world to itself and went back to heaven and forgot about us. No. From the first chapter of the Bible until the last, we find God intimately being involved with His creation, accomplishing His will, doing what only He can do. Yes, God has given us people, his people, plenty of specific things to do ourselves. But he has reserved for himself plenty of things that only he can do, that only he can accomplish. And often he's just waiting us for to ask him to do that for us. If we are wise, we'd open our eyes, open our hearts, and let God be God. Even as we faithfully obey the things he wants us to do. Obviously, we need his help. We need to be filled with the Spirit. We need to be filled with his presence, his word, to do even the part that he's given us to do. But he gets the glory for the part that we do because he empowers us, and he gets all the glory for the part that only he can do. Here's how Daniel records that thought in the Old Testament from Daniel 4:34. For God's dominion is an everlasting dominion. His kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are counted as nothing when compared to God. But God does according to his will in the heavens and among the inhabitants of the earth. And no one can stop God's hand. And no one can say to God, what have you done? Man, God, what'd you do that for? We might ask others that question. It might be a question parents ask kids all the time. And I know kids probably ask parents that. But nobody can say to God, man, what you do? Here's a biblical account of God intervening in a miraculous way, and nobody asking him, what's he doing? It's in 2 Corinthians 20. A little bit of background here. About roughly 900 B.C., Solomon dies. And there's tension between the northern parts of Israel, the 10 tribes, and the southern parts, the 2 tribes, Judah and Benjamin. And they split. The kingdom of Israel with the 10 tribes to the north, the kingdom of Judah with Judah and Benjamin to the south. And we're going to fast forward to the time of Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat was the fourth king of the kingdom of Judah, the lower kingdom. He became one of the country's most successful rulers for one simple reason. He followed the commands of God. That was a pretty simple agenda, wasn't it? It wasn't complicated. He wasn't perfect. None of the kings were, and none of the people were, none of we are, but he came after his father Asa, who was the first good king over Judah, and Jehoshaphat reigned over Judah. He was 35 years old when he became king of Judah, and he reigned for 25 years. And he walked in the ways of his father Asa, and he did not stray from them, Scripture says, and he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. Good King Jehoshaphat. Now in 2 Chronicles 20, I'm going to skip some of the verses, but I'm going to read some of those verses, starting from the top. Moab and Ammon, together with the nation of Edom, went to war against Jehoshaphat, 3 nations against the kingdom of Judah. And messengers told Jehoshaphat, a large army from Edom, east of the Dead Sea, has invaded our country, and they're already over there in En-Gedi. Jehoshaphat was afraid, so he asked the Lord what to do. It's wise, isn't it? And he told the people of Judah to go without eating to show their sorrow. They went into a fast. Then they immediately left for Jerusalem to ask for the Lord's help. Remember, a lot of times they went for special events to Jerusalem to pray and seek God. They went to Jerusalem. And verse 5, Jehoshaphat stood in front of the courtyard in Jerusalem, and this is what he prayed. Just go to verse 10 there now. He's talking to God. You can see the armies of Ammon and Moab and Edom. They're attacking us. Lord, those are the nations that you wouldn't let our ancestors invade on their way to Egypt, so these nations were not destroyed. These nations are still here. Now they're coming to take back the land you gave us. Are you going to punish them? We won't stand a chance against these armies. We don't know what to do. We are begging for your help. That's what it says in verse 12. Verse 13, while every man, woman, and child of Judah was standing there praying at the temple, the Lord's Spirit suddenly spoke to Jehaziel. You may not have heard that name before. He was a Levite from the Asaph clan. They were musicians, remember? Asaph even wrote some of the Psalms. And this is what the Spirit of God spoke through Jehaziel. Your Majesty Jehoshaphat and everybody from Judah and Jerusalem, the Lord says you don't need to be afraid. You don't need to let this powerful army discourage you. God will fight on your side. So here's what you must do. Tomorrow, the enemy will march to the desert around the town of Jeruel. March down and meet them at the town of Ziz as they come up the valley. You won't even have to fight. Just take your positions and watch the Lord rescue you from your enemy. Don't be afraid. Just do as you're told. As you march out tomorrow, the Lord will be there with you. Jehoshaphat bowed low to the ground, and everyone worshiped the Lord. They got clear direction. God's promise to be with them. God's promise to have the victory. And clear direction of what they should do. They should see, just stop and see the salvation of the Lord. Hold their positions and do as you're told. Verse 19, then some of the Levites stood up and shouted praises to the Lord God of Israel. Isn't that awesome? They just spontaneously started praising and worshiping God. Verse 20, early the next morning, as everyone got ready to leave, Jehoshaphat stood up and he said, listen, my friends, and this is the kind of king you want, isn't it? If we trust the Lord God and believe what the prophets have told us, the Lord will help us and we will be successful. Then he explained his plan. He appointed men to march in front of the army and to praise the Lord for his holy power for singing. And this is what they were singing, or by singing. Praise the Lord, his love never ends. Would you love to hear that? Praise the Lord, his love never ends. As soon as they began singing and worshiping, verse 22, the Lord confused the enemy camp. The Lord confused the enemy camp. So the Ammonite and the Moab tribes attacked and destroyed those from Edom. Then they turned against each other and fought until the entire camp was wiped out. And the kingdom of Judah, the Judah tribe, and the Benjamin tribe are just sitting there watching this. When Judah's army reached the tower, they overlooked the desert, and they saw that every soldier in the enemy's army was lying dead on the ground. Then on the fourth day, they were there several days. On the fourth day, everyone came together in Baraka Valley. They sing praises to the Lord, heartfelt. It says in verse 26, that's why that place was called Praise Valley. Verse 27, Jehoshaphat led the crowd back to Jerusalem. As they were marched, they played harps, they blew trumpets. They were very happy because the Lord had given them victory over their enemies. So when they reached the city, they went straight to the temple for more worship. And when the other nations heard how the Lord had fought against Judah's enemies, they were too afraid to invade Judah. Man, we're out of here. They got the Lord on their side. And the Lord let Jehoshaphat's kingdom be at peace. That is awesome. The key to the whole passage, in my opinion, is verse 17. When the Lord gave his instructions, just take your positions and watch the Lord rescue you from your enemy. Stop fluttering around. Just soar. Just see what God can do. Don't be afraid. Just do as you're told. You'll march out tomorrow. The Lord will be there with you. Jehoshaphat and the kingdom of Judah obeyed the word from the Lord, spoken through a prophet named Jahaziel. The whole kingdom saw it, and we get to read about it. Of the Lord's faithfulness to do what no human being could have ever done that day. No human could have got rid of those three armies. This is God intervening in the affairs of men and doing what only God can do. There are numerous other biblical examples in both the Old and the New Testament. And God loves to do that. I love to read about it, but I also love to see it. Don't you? I want to see it. And so what about today in our country? How about a modern day example of God intervening in the affairs of men, even this week? I've got one. You see, 2020 was the year of first for me. I learned about COVID-19. Did you? I learned about face mask. I learned about 6-foot zones. I was rebuked a few times for being just 5 feet. I learned about vaccinations. I learned about voting irregularities. These are things I never actually said out of my mouth before. I learned about a group called Boston Pride. And pride has a whole different meaning these days. I learned about a group called BLM. I really had very little or even no idea of these things before this last year. They weren't even part of my vocabulary. We've all learned some new things, new terms in 2020, didn't we? But the Boston Pride Group is a pro-homosexual agenda group that's been organized for 50 years. And it's supported by Planned Parenthood and GLAAD, which is an interesting name, and a bunch of other, I would say, nefarious groups bent on transforming the thinking and the actions of your children and grandchildren concerning the biblical standards of godly marriages, the reality of two God-given genders, and everything good and right about sexual intimacy in true marriages. They want to distort all that. They're called Boston Pride. They have ever-changing beliefs about these things, and true biblical teaching on these topics is of no concern of theirs. They're far removed from that. By the way, the Bible's very clear in those subjects, and I'll get to the modern-day example here in a second, but you can look it up yourself. But the plain teaching of God in the Bible is that marriage is a covenant relationship between one man and one woman for life. That's God's definition. That's God's plan. And you can read it just as well as I can. Also, it's plain in Scripture and in science. I got two children that are doctors. There's only two genders, male and female. Period. You can read it yourself just like I did. Male and female, he made them. And also, the bonding, the pleasurable experience of sexual intimacy is designed by God to take place in a biblical marriage covenant between a man and a woman. These things are not hard to get from the Bible. You might want to wait till your kids are a little older before you read them Song of Solomon, like I have, but it's a glorious book. It's taught in plain language. There's no need to know Greek or Hebrew. You can understand it in English. And they're not hidden from anybody. The Bible's the oldest, longest printing book in the history of mankind. And it's available for everybody. But the Boston Pride Group is a strong, politically motivated group with no local ties that I'm aware of. I never heard about it locally here. But they've been organized for the last 50 years. And I would be honest with you, I have no idea how to help change the thinking of that group, other than pray for them. I really don't think it's my battle, except to pray for them. I do know that I can also teach my children and others in my circle of influence about what God himself has said about these things, like gender and marriage and sexual intimacy. But other than that, I'd have no clue to help the people in Boston Pride. Obviously, if I met somebody who was in that group, I would hope for a God-given opportunity to share the gospel with them and encourage them toward truth. But another group that I learned about in 2020 is BLM, Black Lives Matter. And I want you guys to know I agree that black lives do matter. You bet they do. In fact, I talked to a brother yesterday that just came back from George Washington Carver's place over in Missouri. He said it's the most incredible museum place he's ever been to. But I also haven't believed that little baby, black baby lives matter also. And I'm disgusted that black babies are being aborted at the highest rate than any other ethnicity. That disgusts me. The illogicalness of all that. And that group doesn't say a thing about that, by the way. However, unlike BLM, I also happen to believe that all lives matter. Every life matters. Whatever the color of skin may happen to be. I've got relatives on both sides of my family that have black skin, and they still love me, even though I got white skin. According to the New York Post website, the damage caused by BLM riots in 2020 to personal property, to state properties, to federal properties across multiple cities exceeds $10 billion. And most time, insurance excludes acts of terrorism. So I don't think the insurance industry is going to be footing the bill. anytime soon. Hundreds of police officers were injured in the riots, and at least 36 people were killed in those riots. Many businesses were irreparably damaged, and financial livelihoods were lost forever. This is a group who apparently cannot be stopped by anybody. They kill, they injure police officers, and nobody dares to get in their way. They control even what people say. They are only good with you saying that Black Lives Matters. And I don't have any trouble saying that. But that's all they want you to say. If you say that all people matter, or that all lives matter, they might come and get you also, because they say that's a racist comment. But as Christians, we correctly believe that all lives matter. That's why we even sing, and we teach our children to sing. Red, brown, yellow, black, and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves all the children of the world. Black Lives Matter is a strong, politically motivated group with no local ties. I have no idea how to help the thinking of people in that group. I don't know any of them. But I can teach my children and others about what God Himself has said about His love for people of every language, every tribe, every nation, and all the people of the world mattering to God. But other than a prayer and instructing those around me, I don't know that anymore that's my battle, to be honest with you. Obviously, if I met somebody in that group, I would hope for an opportunity to share the gospel with them and to love on them. However, this week a situation came forward involving BLM that completely shut down Boston Pride. And you'd have to say this was God intervening in the affairs of the nation. That's how I concluded. There was confusion in the camp, just like there was back in the kingdom of Judah. The camp of those who want to systematically destroy the lives and property of others. Black Lives Matter actually attacked the Boston Pride group. BLM blamed and accused Boston Pride that their group was too white for their liking, and they wanted to shut them down. Obviously, wanting to avoid another outbreak of violence that BLM is well known for, Boston Pride obediently stood down. They shrank back, they responded by apologizing, and they completely disbanded the 50-year organization this week in apparent shame for supposedly being too white. BLM comes in, tears apart one of its own allies for no discernible, accurate reason, and everybody on that side is left powerless to even stop them. They're so backed in the corner that they've made themselves. There's no ability and no freedom to even raise their voices in objection. And just like that, there's no longer a group called Boston Pride. It's completely disbanded. It officially disorganized. I saw their website. Without any body from the other side doing one thing. God intervened in the affairs of man. God's got this, guys. Let's just wait and see the salvation of the Lord and the victory of the Lord. Who else in our culture would have the ability to disband such a long-standing, nefarious group? Anybody? You see, eventually, unrighteous causes, deviant organizations, and perverted groups move and attack other false teaching groups and often wind up destroying and eating their own. This type of action, confusion in the opposition, will usually produce opportunities for the church to share the light of the gospel to people who are desperate for hope. That's what usually drew them to the organizations to begin with. They're looking for light and hope and life. People stuck in false teaching and beliefs of the homosexual movement and people in racist groups like BLM all need to come to the light of the true gospel. And when they attack each other, it presents God-given opportunities to shine God's truth for people to see and to get free from these falsehoods. We have the message. So we looked at the biblical example from Jehoshaphat's days, and there are plenty of them in the Bible, and God certainly has intervened in the affairs of nations and the affairs of people. And we looked at a modern-day example even this week of God just taking things down in His own way. And God certainly intervenes into the affairs of our own nation and the affairs of our fellow citizens. But what about your life? Does God still intervene in the affairs of your life? Notice the progression in the nation of Judah and the situation this week in our own nation. it follows a pattern. There's a very difficult situation developing over the course of a long length of time. 50 years, Boston Pride has been developing. Jehoshaphat was the fourth king in the kingdom of Judah. There appears to be no earthly answer to make the situation ever right again. Who's going to come up against these three nations? Who's going to take down this organization? God's people, familiar with the truth and the difficult situation, begin to pray. Sometimes it even calls for fasting and prayer, as Jehoshaphat asked for. Then God graciously hears the prayers of his people. Sometimes God gives his people reminders to do what he's already told them they should be doing. Hey, church, we got a lot of things we should be doing, don't we? We actually shouldn't be waiting to hear from God. Well, what do you want me to do? Hey, there's a book full of it, the New Testament. You know, when Christ comes back, will he find faith on the earth? Will he find people busy about his Father's business? There's plenty of things to do. Sometimes God simply exhorts people to continue to live faithfully for him, doing the things that he wants us to be doing, and trusting him for the things that only he can resolve. God brings a solution that is undeniably him, doing only what he can do, in Jehoshaphat's days and our own days. God saves the day and completely changes the situation, like that. And finally, what was devastation and misery is now changed, and things immediately begin to look incredibly better. I mean, you just get a sense in the scriptures that the kingdom of Judah was like, yes, we're doing great. And I imagine there's those who've been praying and working with and hoping for answer to the prayers about Boston Pride. And you know they're rejoicing for the news they got this week. But where are you at in your life, in your current challenges, whatever they might be? Do you have a hopeless medical or health condition? Do you have a difficult relationship in your life that you have no control over? Are you having some kind of financial problem or job-related difficulty? Are you presently pressed or even depressed, disheartened or downcast about something in your life? Do you have a difficult situation in your life that you just cannot solve? Is there nothing you can do right now to right your situation? Can you pray for that situation? And have you prayed? And are you walking with God even in the midst of your situation? Are you talking to him? Are you seeking him through his living and active and powerful word? Yes, God wants to intervene in the affairs of our nation, but God also wants to intervene in the affairs of our life. God wants to show himself strong to you right in the middle of tribulation. Remember Paul having joy in the middle of his tribulation? Comforted in the middle of his tribulation? Now back to Jehoshaphat. Four chapters earlier, Jehoshaphat's father was Asa. There was a word from the Lord for King Asa too, Jehoshaphat's father. And Jehoshaphat was likely aware of this, being that he was his son. But this is what it says in 2 Chronicles 16:9. Yet because you relied on the Lord, he delivered them into your hand. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. That gives you a little understanding about Jehoshaphat's foundation, doesn't it? He heard the word of the Lord that his father was given. The eyes of the Lord are running to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. You know what I hear when I hear that? I hear God's intervening in the lives of men. In fact, his eyes are looking for ways to intervene. There's a loyal person. I can help that person. Is your heart loyal to the things of God? Don't let the question just pass by unanswered. But is your heart loyal to the things of God? And does your life demonstrate loyalty to God? The personal application for this message is simple. It's an application for myself too. We're all on the same table. Acknowledge your difficult situation to God, whatever it might be. He already knows about it anyway, doesn't he? But let's just get it up on the table for your own sake and just for an honesty between you and God. Here it is, Lord, that thing. And pray for his answer. God, help me. Pray for his intervening into your affairs, into your difficulty. Fast and pray if God wants you to do that. Third thing is completely give yourself over to faithfully walking with God, seeking the Lord, talking to him, digging into his word, gaining comfort even from godly people around you like Paul received from Titus. But be serious about it. Be loyal to it. Let it become you. Let it start defining you, a pursuit of God wholeheartedly. Wouldn't you want that? I'm defined by a wholehearted pursuit of God. Wouldn't you want people to say that about you? Number four, get rid of any distractions he might show you. Shed the things out of your life that are bringing you down. Repent of any sin that he might show you. And fill up those areas of repentance with an intent pursuit of good, right, and noble things. After you swept the house clean, don't leave it empty. Don't leave it vacant. Fill it up with the life-giving things of God, the pursuit of godly things. Number five, and as you're stepping forward in your life, loyally doing the next thing that you know he wants you to do, continue to wait on him and watch for his answers to come. Like the kingdom of Judah did. Like those who probably for 50 years have been praying for Boston Pride did. And finally, six, rejoice in any and all answers to your prayers for your situation. Sing, praise, rejoice like the kingdom of Judah did for days after the Lord fought for them. Let's pray. Father, you certainly do intervene into the affairs of people. You've done it. It's recorded all through the Bible. You've done it. It's recorded in the history of the nations of the world, including our own nation, Lord. Lots of recorded interventions from God. You've even intervened in the affairs of our own life, Lord. We'd have many testimonies this morning of you doing just that thing. You want to be intimately involved, actively empowering, and accomplishing your will through your people. We bless you for that. Thank you. While we're praying, you know, guys, just ask the Lord. Maybe something came to your mind, Lord, I need help with this situation, or with this person, or with this thing, or in these circumstances. Just ask, just put it on the table before God and say, Lord, I know it, you know it. Would you please help me in this situation? And Lord, we thank you for revealing yourself to us. We thank you for your kindness and willingness to intervene in the affairs of our lives. We love you. We want to continue to grow in our love for you. Thank you for the hope that comes knowing that you have revealed yourself through us. Thank you for the hope that comes knowing that you want to intervene in our affairs. We bless you, Lord. Thank you that we are not orphaned. We have the help and the comfort we need from you. In Jesus' name, amen.